what does the perfect startup team look like, right? And I don't know if you should think about it like an entrepreneur or you should think about it like an investor. And I guess those two mindsets may be the same and may change. How does it look in your opinion? I'll share mine.
I think there are two things to it. The first is, of course, it's a team of people who are very complementary.
Yeah.
Some of them are outgoing sales-minded, some of them are perhaps introverts and nerds, but execute systematically. Some have the mindset that they do project management, and others just focus on one thing, but don't look at the whole thing. So the other view that I have is that I really love if you can recruit an entire startup team that came from another startup.
Yeah.
So some, you know, my experience is that in a startup, there's a lot of turbulence. Every startup I've worked in, you have people coming in and out all the time. Also at the managerial level, the CEOs, there can be a lot of turbulence because it's so hard. And if you have a high growth, high pressure startup that works for some years, and at the end of it, you have this core team that survived all this and found out that they really like to work with each other and they found out how to work together, I'd love to take such a whole team and put into the next startup. And that is actually
quite... Is that something you would like to do and something you have tried, or something you would like to do and you believe it will work?
I have tried parts of it, to take groups from startups, and it's not necessarily stealing them, but a startup has an exit, gets sold or goes down, and then you have this team. And they like to work together, and they're looking for an opportunity to work together in a new startup. And then you adapt that whole...
And if I had to put my sort of negative hat on, I would say, why would you take a team that hasn't been successful? Isn't that taking a football club that hasn't been successful and win the Premier League that they're going to be successful?
You can still have great teams and companies that are not successful because there's so much chance and risk at the very early stages of a startup. So you can still have that.
Yeah. That's a good point. So it could be that they were just unfortunate, they didn't have the product market fit, for example. Yeah, they're the right team, but just went on the wrong business model. I find that often actually as well, that you can actually have a great entrepreneur who's just not good at selecting his business model, or is bad at selecting the market, or was too early, or was too late, or was unfortunate for whatever reason. Mm. I think if I look at my experience, I think there's a couple of things. I think one is, the hunter-farmer thing, which I think you touched upon, right? Which is somebody needs to be able to produce the product and somebody needs to be able to sell the product. So it's important to have both. You don't want to be two hunters. Mm. If you're two salespeople, nobody's going to produce the product. I think it's important. I usually say to our teams, we want to have similar goals, similar culture, and similar values, but we want to have different skills. Mm. And I think diversity is key there, but it's diversity on skills, on ability, not on where you're heading. So I find very often people are very enthusiastic about diversity and they say, look, we want to have a diverse team, and then they end up with teams that are running in different directions. Mm. So I think it's so important you're running the same direction, but then you have different skills of how to get there.
Exactly, yes. I have another thing about diversity, because diversity is a big buzzword now. It's been on and off for my entire life. But as you say, it's diversity and skills you want. Yeah. I absolutely don't care color, sex, whatever.
No.
These kind of things I think are completely
irrelevant. Any of the 45 irrelevant genders doesn't really matter at all.
It doesn't matter at all. You should completely ignore that and just go for what is a diverse team in terms of skills that can execute as one when they are combined.
But I find it so important that you have that diversity of skills and to some degree some sort of mindset, but that you are aligned on where you're heading. I've seen teams as well where somebody wants to build a big business, somebody wants to build a small, somebody wants to go international, somebody wants to stay local, somebody wants to go into services, somebody wants to go into products, right? And it just creates conflicts, and so you end up arguing all the time.
I think that you're touching on a very important point. That is, when a group of people want to start a startup, maybe there are two or three people, that you have a serious discussion early on about what is the purpose of this. But it could be that, for instance, you and I, we start a company together.
Yeah.
For you, it's a lifestyle project. Yeah. You want to have that that company forever. And for me, it's I want to build it up and sell it for a fortune within 5 years.
Yeah.
And then, of course, if we don't talk about it in the beginning, it will come, it will surface later and be a contention point.
Yeah.
And you can have so many different differences of opinion. Also, perhaps, to say something that's not very realistic, you want to work 30 hours a week and I want to work 90.
Yeah.
And of course, I will get very frustrated by you. You probably also get frustrated by me, because it's not what you're looking for. You're not looking for this high stress thing that I'm looking for.
I just realized we should almost create a list, and we can even create the list. And somebody, if they comment below this video, they can get the list of what are the things you need to clear off with your co-founder. That would actually be a very cool list.
Yeah. Mm.
Like, go through these questions before you start a business with someone, just to make sure you're aligned.
Yeah. And that is an informal discussion, but it also should be reflected in a shareholders agreement.
Yeah.
And I have to say that I always want to have a shareholders agreement, but in all honesty, in most cases, it takes up to a year from we start until we actually get that shareholders agreement written out.
Yeah.
It just very often works like that.
Yeah.
But ideally, I'd do it before anything, before you incorporate a company or anything, you make a shareholders agreement. You can always adjust it later.
Yeah. And why do you find it takes a year? And I don't disagree with that experience, by the way.
It's turbulence in the beginning. In the beginning, it might not even be clear who are the founders, because there's a group of people who are talking about doing this, and maybe there are five or six people discussing, and in the end, it's only two that actually run with it.
Yeah.
But you didn't know in the beginning that they would go it. And also, I've done many startups where afterwards I was thinking, how was it actually that we started it? And what I found is that we just started working on the project without having the company.
Yeah.
And worked for quite a long time on the idea of the project and all elements of what we could do. And then quite late in the process, we say, oh, we better actually make a corporation.
Yeah.
And then you get that done, and then maybe already many months have passed, and then later on you get all the formalities done.
Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching this clip. I really hope you enjoyed it. Comment below so I can follow your journey. I can be part of your life, and hopefully you'll be part of mine as well. And if you haven't already done it, click subscribe below, and we can be part of this entrepreneurial and leadership and career adventure together.